Ödevle ilgili birkaç tane soru geldi. Ödevi derste sorarsınız falan dedi. Gerçi mahallede çıkmamış ama ödevi bir şey yapıyorum. Tamam, ödevde esasında paging falan yapmayacaksınız. Virtual memory'niz, virtual memory'niz birazcık ters çalışıyor ödevde. Virtual memory'niz sizin için sıfırdan 16K'ya kadar virtual memory'niz var. Bu sizin virtual memory'niz 0'dan 16K'ya kadar. Physical memory'niz daha büyük. O 0'dan 64K'ya kadar. 64K'ya kadar tam tersi gibi çalışıyor yani. Sizin göreviniz dolayısıyla bu physical memory içerisinde 4 tane aynı anda proses çalıştırabilirsiniz. Sizin göreviniz 4 tane prosesi aynı anda en fazla çalıştırıp kullanırsa Robin algoritması, scheduling algoritması çalıştırmak. Ödevin temelinde bu var. Paging falan yok yani. Paging'i falan koymadık. O ağır olur diye düşündüm bu ödev için. Çünkü yapacak epeyce bir iş var. Bunları implement edebilmek için birkaç tane işletim sistemi call implement edeceksiniz. Diğer ödev birdekileri kapat bloğunun üzerine fork implement edeceksiniz. Exec bir de wait PID'yi implement edeceksiniz bunların hepsini. Bunları implement ettikten sonra birkaç tane program yazmanızı bekliyorum sizden. İlk program shell programı. Bayağı shell programı gibi çalışacak. Hani bir tane kitapta örnek vardı ya. Kullanıcıdan bir tane commit bekliyor. Kullanıcı mesela sort diyecek. İşte yani sort programımız vardı ya, bir tane 10 tane sayı sort ediyoruz, sonra sonuçlara basıyoruz, hatırlamıyorum. Ondan sonra yapıp bitirip tekrar bir daha isteyecek, yapıp bitirip tekrar isteyecek. Böyle bir tane shell programı. İstediğim kadar ASM programına, compile olmuş ASM programı çalıştırabileceğim. İkincisi de işte parallel denen başka bir tane program var. İşte 3 tane prosesi aynı anda çalıştıracağım. Bu proseslerin ne olduğunu zaten yazdım oraya. Ödev genelde bu. Yani anlatması kolay. Biraz da implementasyonda bazı şeyleri düşünmeniz lazım. Tasarım kararları vermeniz lazım. İşte bu cycle'ların sayılması ile ilgili bazı açıklar var, problemler var. Onları çözmeniz lazım. Ama ödevin içerisinde paging yok. Ödevin içerisinde fiziksel memoriye sığmayan fiziksel memoriye sığmayan proses durumu falan da yok. Tersi gibi çalışıyor. Sığıyor ama 4 tanesi sığıyabiliyor. Tabii ben burada ilk prosesi buraya yükledim, ikincisini buraya, üçüncüsünü ve dördüncüsünü buraya yüklersem eğer buradaki fiziksel adresin gerçek değeri ve şu proses kendi içerisinde çalışırken kullandığı adresler birbirinden farklı. Burası virtual, yani beklediğim burası 0'dan 16K, 0.16, 0.16, 0.16 gibi yani. Bu böyle görüyor, bu böyle, bu böyle, bu da böyle görüyor. Onu ne yapacaksınız? Base ve limit registerleriyle her bir prosesin kendisine sanki 16K'lık hafızası varmış gibi göstereceksiniz. Onun için de bir tane memory management unit yazacaksınız. Benim verdiğim memory manager'dan extend ederek. Bir drive yerim, bir tane sınıfı drive ederek. Tamam.
Memory base'den mi, memory'den mi?
Memory base'den.
Her neyse işte orada bilmiyorum, hatırlamıyorum. Memory'den değil, yok ya, memory base'den yapıp base zaten.
Memory base en üst sınıf, bir tane memory türetmişsiniz orada.
Evet, tamam. Memory'ler uyduruk olsun diye türettim. Onu kullanmayacaksınız tabii ki.
Tamam.
Onu ben sadece, o memory türettim ki bir önceki ödevin memory'si buna benziyordu. Bunun aynısıydı. Zaten bunu kullanmayacaksınız diye yaptım. Şimdi pek bir numara yok mu? Orada iki tane fonksiyon var, add fonksiyon var herhalde. İzlemek için. Tamam.
Bir add, bir physical add var.
Physical add doğrudan physical memory'ye erişmek için o prosesleri kullanmayacaklar tabii ki. Bunu hani işletim sistemi olarak sen onu kullanabilirsin physical add'i. Çünkü hani diğer türlü nasıl yükleyeceksin memory'nin burasına bir şeyi. Yani 32K'ya erişebilmen lazım ama prosesin içerisinde 32K diye bir şey yok. Ben pozorun 6K.
Bu base limit register'larını os mu tutacak yoksa memory dedim. Çünkü memory'yi yazmışsınız.
Memory management unit içerisinde tabii ki base ve limit register'lar. 80-80 doğrudan base ve limit register'ını desteklemiyor. Onları dışarı tutacaksınız. Memory management unit'in içerisinde olacak ve hepsinin, her bir prosesin kendi base ve limit register'ı olacak.
O zaman her proses değiştiğinde biz o base ve limit'i değiştireceğiz şimdi.
Evet. Context switch olduğu zaman diğer register'larla beraber de değişecek. Diğer türlü çalışmaz.
Hocam bu fiziksel adres base'den türemeyecek değil mi?
Ne?
şu 64 K'lık adresleri kendimiz yapacağız. Şeyden türetmeyeceğiz.
Yani. Hayır, elinizde 64 K'lık bir tane fiziksel hafıza var, tamam mı? En fazla da 4 tane 16 K'lık sanal hafıza var. 4 tane prosesör var. Şunun dışında hafızan yok. Tüm hafıza burada. Ama o prosesler kendilerinin 16 K'lık hafızası olduğunu düşünüyorum. Compile olmuş, işte SMD'den geçmiş tüm prosesler. Öyle düşünüyorlar. Yani bir önceki ödevinizde çalışabilecek her türlü .com dosyası burada da çalışabilecek ama aynı anda 4 tanesi çalışabileceksin. SMD koduyla oynamak yok yani bir öncekinin çalışan kodu. Tabii SMD kodu da sadece o sistemi kolları için belki değişiklik yapman gerekebilir ama onun dışında o da gerek yok esasında. Yani belki yani yeni yazacağın kodların yeni sisteme göre yazması lazım ama eski kodların hepsinin yeni sistemde çalışıyor olabilmesi lazım. Yani bizim eski sisteme göre compile olmuş kodu sizin bilgisayarınızda çalıştırabiliriz yani. 4 tanesini de. Aynen. Tamam. Başka soru soran var mı? Okudunuz mu ödevi? Sadece 2-3 kişiden soru geldi. Başlayan var mı?
Ben kodu falan düzenledim başlayacağım. Yani son şeyleri falan.
Tamam. Bir kişi çok az ya. Ödevi bir haftaya geçti değil mi? Geriye kaldı. Yani iki haftadan biraz fazla vermeye çalıştım ki. Tamam, çok geç kalmayın. Ödevi de hesaplamayın. Dediğim gibi ödevi yapmayan dersten geçemeyecek. Başka soru yoksa devam edelim. Okey, sonra dersiniz de Multix TLB Buffer, Translation Locus Hide Buffer. The same, kind of the same technique is applied by the Intel processors, 86x86 processors. The book has a detailed discussion about them, but I will skip this part because it is similar to Multix segmentation with paging. At the end of this chapter, the book discusses this architecture, but I will skip it. So this is the end of this chapter. If you don't have any questions, I will start the next chapter, chapter number 4, which is about files, file systems. Okay, no questions, then I will...
Hocam, memory check'te bitmeden son bir soru sorabilirim.
Evet.
Bazı programlar var, memory'nin bütün neler çalışıyorsa onların şeyini alabiliyor, memory dump alabiliyor. Bu programlar nasıl çalışıyor, yani...
Ne yapabiliyor?
RAM'deki bütün bilgileri alabiliyor. Bu eğer programlar...
Eğer işletim sistemi kernel tarafından desteklenen bir şeyse o, yani o üçüncü bir kullanıcının yazdığı bir şey olduğunu sanmıyorum ama işletim sisteminin güçleniyor. İşletim sisteminin her yere erişme hakkı var değil mi?
İşletim sisteminin ise eğer yapabiliyor değil mi? Yoksa evet. Herhangi bir kullanıcı gelip...
Yok, yapamazsın. Yani herhangi bir kullanıcının eğer kernel modunda değilse, tamam mı? Kendisi... Şimdi driver yazabilirsen, bir driver yazdığın zaman bir cihaz için kernel'ın bazı yerlerine erişebilmen lazım, değil mi? Ona sana izin veriyor. Driver'ı install etmek için de işte super user privilege'in olması lazım. İzin veriyorsun sana. Senin izin verdiğin, administrator olarak izin verdiğin bir program kendisini kernel space içerisine koyabilir. Ama benim gibi şeyin içerisinde olman lazım. Kernel içerisinde olman lazım. Kernel içerisinde zaten mesela task manager nasıl oluyor da bir prosesi öldürebiliyor?
Ama biz zaten işletim sistemini bilmiyoruz.
Tamam, işte onun gibi yani. Task manager nasıl her bir şeyi görebiliyorsa, istediğini yapabiliyorsa, yani yetkin varsa senin kolaycı olarak, o da aynısını yapabiliyor. Tamam, yani herhangi bir, diğer türlü çok kötü ve üstüne şey açmış olursun. Yani herhangi bir program, istediği prosesin istediği yerine girip okuyup değiştirebilirse onu, sistemin üzerine herhangi bir yerden bir program geldiği zaman sistemi alt üst edebilir. Eskiden DOS sistemlerinde falan öyleydi. Koruma diye bir şey yoktu o kadar zayıf sistemlerde. Virüsler çok kötü şeye yol açabiliyordu bu durumda. Hasara yol açabiliyordu çünkü herhangi bir koruma yok. Şeyde öyle bir şey yok ama Linux'te, Windows'un yeni versiyonlarında falan. Eğer sen kendi elinde, ben sana privilege veriyorum demezsen eğer, Adam şu an kendisini körünün içerisine koyamıyor. Bir sistemi upgrade etmek için Linux'te şey geldiği zaman, update geldiği zaman ben update edeceğim. Ne soruyor sana? Password soruyor değil mi? Sistem password'ü. Sistem password'ünü vermezsen update yapamıyorsun. Update yapamadığın zaman da körünün herhangi bir şey değiştiremiyorsun. Tamam mı? Var mı başka soru? İşletim sistemin istediği, yani verdiği bazı mesela PS çağırabilirsin. İsteyen PS'i çağırabilir. Kaç tane proses var görebilirsin. Onda problem yok ama bir çalışan bir prosesi değiştirmek, etkilemek, privacy'sini arttırmak, azaltmak bunlar için şey lazım. Privilege lazım. Tamam. Şimdi memory management chapter'ındayız. Memory management chapter'ını bitirdik. Memory management chapter'ını bitirdik. Ne yapıyorum ben ya? File sistemi başlamamız lazım. Okay, with the file systems. So far, after the introduction chapter, chapter number one. In chapter number two, we abstracted the CPU using the idea of processes. In chapter number three, we abstracted the memory using the virtualization, paging, and segmentation. Now we are going to work on the files, the secondary storage. We will try to abstract the details of the secondary storage or the file system. So this chapter is about abstracting the long-term information storage. You know, the main memory is good for storing temporary files, temporary information, temporary instructions, data. When you power off your computer, all the data goes away because that's a volatile memory. If I want to keep my memory for a long time, tens of years, hundreds of years, then I need to put that information in a different medium, which is called long-term information storage. Okay, so this storage must be very, very large. It should keep large amount of information, much larger than the physical memory, okay, core memory. And the information must survive termination of processes using it. So it should survive if you don't have power for a long time. And multiple processes must be able to access information concurrently. Okay, so these are the three requirements of file systems. If I satisfy all of these three, then I have a successful file system. And using this abstraction of the file, maybe I can satisfy all of these three at the same time. So that's the main idea of this chapter number four. Okay. For the file systems, again, our main abstraction, the file. For chapter number two, the main abstraction name was the process and thread. Okay. For chapter number three, we talked about paging and segmentation. That was the main tools for abstraction. For this chapter, main tool for the abstraction is the file. We call it file. Okay, so three terms: process, paging, segmentation, and file. These three things are the basic abstraction mechanisms of the operating systems. We abstracted away the concept of the processor within the processes. We abstracted away the concept of physical memory with the virtual address spaces by two methods, paging and segmentation. Now we are going to do the same thing with the secondary storage, okay? If you understand the abstraction of the processes, okay, which is the threads and the processes, abstraction of the address spaces, and abstraction of the files, okay, these are the most important concepts. And if you really understand these three, that means that you understand the operating system, okay? At least the concept of the operating system. These are the three most important things in an operating system: processes, virtual memory, and the file system. Three things, okay? If you understand this, then the rest of them are kind of detailed, which is, details are very important, but again, generally, as an introductory course for an undergraduate study, these are so important, file systems. Okay, so a file system for me as an abstracted file, it is a file, a file. Remember the virtual address space? You see the computer operating system says that, okay? This is your virtual address space. It starts from address number 0, it ends here, right? This was my virtual address space. And I can access any byte of them anytime I like. I can read and write, and the rest of the complications larger than the memory or the paging or the segmentation are handled by the operating system. I will use the same idea here for the file system. Okay. I can think the desk, the secondary storage, as a fixed size blocks, and it supports two operations. I can read block number K, I can write the block number K. Okay. So the memory is kind of something like this. It starts from this address 0 to some address, very large address, and I have this block number K. I can read this block number K, and I can write that block number K. And this address is very, this space is very, very large, very, much larger than the memory. So this is the basic abstraction of a file system. And since we are going to use very, very different ways of storing this information on a physical device, sometimes we are going to use tape drives, sometimes we are going to use the hard drives, sometimes we are going to use flash drives. The technology will be very, very different, but it doesn't matter what kind of technology I am using. All I think that there are two operations available: read block K, write block K. Okay. So these two things, very two basic operations. That's the whole abstraction. The memory was not that different. Memory in the memory, I almost did the same thing, but now I am doing the same thing for the secondary storage. Okay. The operations are so simple, but there are many questions that we need to answer. Okay. Some of these questions: how do you find that information? How do you find that K? Okay. It is easy to say read block number K, but how do you find that information? And how do you satisfy protection between the users? One user should not be able to access the other user's data on the desk. How do you know which blocks are free? These are some questions that we need to answer by implementing these file systems. And in this chapter, throughout this chapter, we will try to answer these questions. We will try to describe methods that tries to answer these methods, these questions, and there are many other questions when we introduce new stuff. Okay, so this will be the topic of this chapter. Some design decisions when we try to answer these questions. You need to keep all that data within files, okay? When you have file names, there is a file name question: what kind of file name should I have? And the structure of the files and their directories, and type of access control: read-only, write, read-write, execute, and that kind of stuff. Versioning of these files, fault recovery. This is very important. This is very important. We don't have many fault recovery techniques for the memory. If memory is corrupted, then you are already dead. Okay, nothing can be done. If the memory is corrupted, the process is dead. You cannot do anything. But if there is something wrong with your data on the disk, on your secondary storage, you cannot say that I am dead. You will try to save your data, because that data is supposed to be permanent. It is not supposed to be erased when the computer is off. Okay, so that data is much more important than the data in your memory. If something happens when you are running a program, at most your operating system crashes and you restart your operating system. And you because your data is saved on the disk, you can continue without losing much data. But if you have the same problem with the disk, with the secondary storage, you should not lose your data. Your file system should be fault tolerant against the crashes, disk crashes, secondary storage crashes. Then we have many operations regarding files: creation of the files, moving of a file, copying of a file. And we have many more design decisions related to files and file systems. So we will look at the issues one by one when the time comes. So abstraction is not, abstraction is something very useful for the end user, for the programmer, but it is not that easy to provide abstraction as an operating system. If you have very, very different technologies available as a secondary storage. Okay, let's look at this file names design decisions. And we will talk a little bit about file names and a little bit history. Okay, so that's the definition of a file. File is an abstraction mechanism. Okay, it provides a way to store information on the disk and read it back later. So with the file, I am asking these two things again. Okay, inside this file, inside this data storage mechanism, read block number K, write to block number K. This is what the file gives me. To have a file, you need to give a name to the file. This is a method of keeping the files, and we have been using this for the last 50 years in computers. Files have names, okay? Files have names. Only the first versions of the operating system in the files, they didn't have any names. They didn't have, because the whole operating system had only one or two files. So four or five files maybe. So they had very small number of files for those systems. And nowadays we have millions of files, even on the smallest systems. So I need to give unique file names for each file. So for the file names, I need to be careful. For some systems, file names are case sensitive. For example, for Unix, file names are case sensitive. I know that. For some other systems, it is not case sensitive. For early MS-DOS systems, the file names are not case sensitive. For some systems, extensions are important. For example, for Windows or for early Apple systems, extensions were very, very, very important. For Windows, if the file extension is not .exe, executable file, you cannot execute that file, right? You have to have that kind of extension. For Unix, you have extensions, but extension is not any different than a regular file name. Okay. For some systems, extensions are required. Okay. For example, for Windows system, extensions are required to be able to function as a file. Most systems permit having an extension, and some systems they don't interpret the extension. It says that you can have the extension, but I don't care about the extension. For some systems, extension length is important. For example, the early MS-DOS systems, extensions have to be three letters only. And you cannot have anything other than three letters. It has to be at most three letters. And you have to have always this kind of extension for that kind of system. So extensions are some design issues that the operating system designers decide on. Then the character set. What do I mean by character set? For the file names, character set are important. Somebody explain this to me. What do I mean by saying character set for file name?
Asking you.
Örneğin işte dolar işaretini başlayamaz gibi kısıtlar mı?
You cannot have some special characters in your file name, that's true, yes. That's one thing. The other thing is, for a long time we couldn't have Turkish characters in your file name, right? You cannot have kind of Turkish characters. You cannot have those kind of characters. Even today, for some systems, when you are copying files between two different systems, if you have character sets, characters other than the ASCII characters in your file, it might create some problems. When you are copying files from Linux to Windows, it creates some problems time to time. So that's an issue again. And uniform and non-uniform filing scheme, some for example, length of the file name. If you put some limit to the length of the file name, everything becomes uniform. If you let the file name to be very very long, you lose that uniformity. These are all design issues, design decisions regarding the file names. It's a simple issue, but it's very important. As I said, if you don't make good decisions on your character set, it is not possible to move, copy your file from one system to another system in the character set. Okay, this is about files and file names. When we come to file system, this is the definition of the file system directly from the book. File system. File system is part of the operating system that deals with the files is known as the file system. Okay, the part of the operating system that deals creates the files, modifies the files, it lets you read and write the files. That part of the operating system is the file system. Okay, and the file system is the main subject of this chapter. Many different file systems. These are FAT16 MS-DOS file system, very very early file systems, and some part of this file system comes from 1960s. Okay, then more modern file systems, 32 file system starting from Windows 98. Then we have NTFS from the Windows NT. Starting from Windows 8, we have Resilient file system. It is not that popular, but it has some extra features. Then we have for Windows 10, EXFAT for flash drives and large file systems, because FAT32 is not enough for these kind of systems. So these are some examples of file systems. When we talk about details, of the file systems, we will come back to these and try to compare these file systems. For the Linux type of file systems, we have nowadays EXT, right? EXT file systems, EXT3, EXT4 file systems. Okay, and one operating system can support, for example, Windows 10. It supports this NTFS, of course. Linux operating system can support this NTFS too, but it is native default file system is this one for the Linux operating system. So operating systems might support the file systems of the other systems operating system. They cannot be that efficient. For example, don't expect Linux to be very efficient on this file system, but supporting is something, being efficient is something other. Linux is most efficient if you are using this file system. Most efficient and most compatible. Okay. We have rules for file naming or the extension naming. And I'm sure you all know these. These are some typical file extensions. As I said, for Unix, it doesn't mean anything if you have a HTML extension, or if you have a .pdf extension. It doesn't mean much, because when I from the console, when I say ls, it just lists them, okay? But if you are using a graphical user interface, if you double click on a file named a.jpg, it automatically calls a JPEG weaving application. So it might be important for the user interfaces, but for the Linux operating system, extension doesn't mean anything. It's just a file for itself, for the operating system. For the user interface, it might be different. Since the user interface is part of the operating system for the Windows, extensions are important for Windows. Extensions are important for Windows. And that's why we know most of these file extensions. Okay. So when I rename a file from one extension to another extension in Linux, it is just a simple rename. It is not anything special. But if you try to do the same thing with the Windows, okay, change the extension of a program. Windows most of the time doesn't let you do that. If you can do it, it gives you an error. If it gives a warning message saying that if you do this, you will lose some of the functionality of this system. So it depends. The importance of the file extension depends on the interpretation of the file extension by the operating system. Okay. When you give, okay, what kind of structure should we give to our files? For Windows and Linux, a file is structured like a simple array. Okay, this is my file. Okay, and these are my bytes, ordered bytes. This is the structure. Okay, randomly addressable sequence of bytes for Linux and Windows. It's just a big array, very, very big array, like the memory, okay? Memory is the same thing as, memory is has a similar structure. For Windows, Unix and Windows, the file structure is very, very simple. Just an order set of bytes, I can randomly access any of them, any time. This is the structure imposed by Unix and Windows. For some other systems, they are page-oriented. The sequence is not bytes of data, the sequence of page size blocks, something like this. So this is the structure for the Windows or Unix type system. For the other types of system, it is again ordered data, but each element is a record. Okay, each element is a record. These are older systems. More modern systems are using this kind of a structure as the file structure. Okay, so in the old days they were using these kind of structures, and each record in this case would correspond to a punch card. Remember the punch cards? Punch card is kind of an 80 column card that can contain some information on that. So since all the data are input to the system using the punch cards, so when you read the punch card, you make each punch card a record, another record, and another record, and you keep your data, you keep your files as a collection of punch cards or the records. Okay, that was the older days. In the older days again, your data is instead of keeping your ordered bytes in a file. In the older days, they used to keep the data in this way. What kind of data is this? What kind of structure is this? You remember this one?
B3, right?
It is B3. B3 was very, very famous, even though today it is very famous. In the 1960s, they structured the data using a B3 fashion. What is the advantage of this? The advantage is it's very efficient to make a search on this data. Let's say I want to find if I have a lamb. Okay, so I look at this one. This is not lamb. I look at this one. This is not lamb, but this is smaller than lamb. Pig is larger than. So I am making this alphabetical listing. Lamb should be between fox and pig. Okay, so I follow this link. This is not lamb, but lamb should be between goat and lion. So I follow this link. This is not lamb. Okay, this lamb I found. So this is a very efficient way of searching for data. Instead of accessing the data directly by the address, the index address, I am accessing the data using this binary search, or it's not the binary search, but fast search algorithm, logarithmic search algorithm. And this is an example from the older system. But nowadays, most of the systems are structured like this. It is very, very simple. It's like a virtual address space. Order set of bytes, and I can access any of them as I want. Okay, so Linux and Unix has this philosophy. They say that having the operating system regard file as nothing more than byte sequences provides the maximum amount of flexibility. Okay, I have the maximum amount of flexibility because I don't have to follow the record structure. I don't have to follow the BT structure. If I wanted to implement this BT structure, then I have this. I can implement this structure on this kind of primitive structure. So I have the maximum flexibility if I have this file structure. Okay, so that's the basic idea of the Linux and Windows operating system, modern operating systems. Okay, there are different types of files. Regular files are the files that contain user information. They could contain the images, videos, executable programs, or the program source files, etc. Those are the regular files that contain the user information. Directories are again files, but they contain the names of other files, including directories, the structure of the file system. There are special files for some special operating system. Character special files, for example, especially for the Unix operating system. These character special files are related to input-output from the serial I/O devices. What's a serial I/O device? Serial I/O device? Like a mouse, or the keyboard, or those kind of devices are serial I/O devices, like the terminals, printers, mouse, keyboard, networks. So the bytes are coming one by one after the other. You don't do any random access, okay? When you get the data from your printer, when you send the data to your printer, you send the data byte by byte. You don't do random access, you don't do random sending. Everything is ordered. These are called special files, character special files. And there are block special files, okay? They are used to model the disk. With the block special files, you can do random access, you can do a large file input-output. And we will, in this chapter, we will be mostly interested in these kind of block special files. Okay? Block special files and regular directories. We will not talk much about this special files or the details of the block special files, because these are related to the devices, and for the devices, we have a complete separate chapter for the I/O. Okay, so do you know which files are these for the Unix operating system? This one and this one. Do you know where are these files? Where these files are on the Unix operating system? There is a special directory called /dev, right? Device directory. Do I have that directory in my?
Hocam, popüler
demolition of the. There is my mouse.
Hocam, FIFO da bu karakter spesifine giren mi?
Ne?
FIFO.
Onlar daha da özel dosyalar. Karakter special değil. See, this is my. Let me do this. This is LL and dev. Okay. So these are my special files. There is a block special file. This is, I don't know what this is. There are terminals, these are blocks, character special files, C, this is a C. Terminals, and again, these are special files, my standard error, standard in and standard out, character special files. And these are all connected to, I guess, STD out is screen, STD, FD0 is the keyboard, right? Okay, so if I send something to this file, if I copy, what do I, okay, you know this echo you know this command, right? If I send the output of this echo to dev and std out, I am sending it to a file, but that file happens to be a special file. When I do this, what do I do? What do I see? I will see the same output because I am sending this to a special file, and that special file is connected to a serial I/O device. That serial I/O device is, happens to be my screen. Okay. So these kind of abstractions make these special files. I have both special files and character special files. Okay. But in this chapter, we will mostly talk about regular files. Block special files and regular files are kind of related, but details of these files will come in the next chapter. Okay. For the file types, when you open a file, depending on the type of the file, structure makes a difference. For example, this is an executable file from the Unix operating system. At the beginning, there is a magic number for an executable program. What is the magic number?
Direkt yazıyoruz. 100.
So what is a magic number? Why do I write a magic number at the beginning of the executable file? Niye ihtiyacımız var buna? Sihirli rakam. Sihirli rakamın sihirli olmadığının farkındasınız değil mi? sihirli bir şey yok, farkındasınız.
İnternet projesi mesela hani yerini aşıp bir yere yazınca hani bizim şeyimizi değiştirmesin mi acaba programımızda?
Hayır,
kime ait olduğu zaten var. File'in olduğu zaten var.
Dosyanın özelliğini gösteriyor olabilir mi? PDF ise, mix ise.
Hayır, onlar extension'dan falan geliyor. Ama bu, bir dakika, bu magic number sadece executable file'ın başında var. Ne bu magic number? Onun executable olduğunu söylüyor. Orada şimdi, magic number diyelim ki 64 bitlik bir tane rakam. 64 bitlik bir tane rakamın tesadüfen bir executable dosyayı gösteren magic number olma ihtimali çok az. Diyorsun ki executable dosyaların hepsi şu magic number'la başlar diyorsun. Dolayısıyla işletim sistemi bir programı çalıştırmaya başlamadan önce bu magic number orada mı değil mi ona bakıyor. Ufak bir tane check, yani bu gerçekten bir çalışabilen dosya mı değil mi ona bakıyor.
Ama hocam Excel işini de bakarak anlıyor zaten demediniz mi? Yani
Hayır, Unix'te extension diye bir şey yok ki.
Hayır, Unix'te.
Windows'da var. Windows'da var. Windows'da belki bu magic number var, yok hatırlamıyorum. Tamam. After the magic number, I have the text size. This is the instruction size. Okay, instruction space. And the data size. I don't know what BSS size means. And we have the symbol tables. And we have the entry point. Entry point is important. It says that your program will start at this position. And we have the same thing. With our assembly languages, assembly language programs for the homeworks, okay? And we have some special flags. Then we have our instructions, our data, some relocation bits, and the symbol table. This is my executable file. And the second one is an archive file, a stored file. And this is an archive file. It's an archive of a library, I guess. We have a header, and we have the object module, another header, another object module. It's the structure of this kind of file, and inside the header, I have the module name, date, owner, protection, and size. So the structure of the files differs from file type to file type, and each one has its own file type. I can do this kind of structuring for different files, because the operating system provides me. What the operating system provides me is this, just this. Okay, I give you a byte addressable structure. You do whatever you want. Okay, whoever has designed this archive types, they decided that my structure should be this way. Operating system doesn't care about how you use your files. Okay, so this is the file type. Okay, let's stop here and we will continue on Monday if there are no questions. Tomorrow, Mohamed will be here to do the problem session. Read the homework, and if you have any questions, come back tomorrow with your questions. Don't be too late about discussing the homework.